Kia ora and welcome. This week on TVNZ Football Club, football didn't come home after the World Cup, but England did, crashing back down to earth in defeat. We try and make sense of the UEFA Nations League. What does it mean for the future of European football? Meanwhile, Neymar's theatrics from the World Cup came back to haunt him in hilarious fashion in the US. And is a former Chelsea star on his way to the Wellington Phoenix? Plus, Chris Chang's beloved Western Suburbs fall in the Chatham Cup to Birkenhead, while Dunedin Technical take out the maiden Kate Shepherd Cup. Club football may be on an international break, but we aren't. And this morning, I'm joined by Mr. Jack Mbeer, Mr. Victor Valdez-Waters and Simon Plummer to have a look at what's been going on. Let's start off with international football this week. Of course, we're in the international break. And England back down to earth with a 2-1 defeat to Spain, despite going up early.
Maybe a bit of a reality check, is it, for the England fans?
Absolutely.
You know, a huge outpouring of goodwill after the World Cup, and they did so well there. And now they're coming back and perhaps learning where the gulf is, you know, in terms of those top international sides.
From what I saw, I thought they played quite exciting attacking football, more exciting and attacking football than we might have expected from English teams of the past. Still, obviously, a pretty young squad. But, you know, I thought their performance in Russia was overrated. I didn't personally buy into the hype.
I'm with you, mate.
I'm
with you. Look, I think the other thing with England, I think we have to understand, is it's a long, drawn process. This is the start of a future project. You have to understand, against Spain, a lot of these players have been playing for years with this possession-based style. Mm. England's trying to implement that now, but it's not going to come off
The Spanish did have some young players up front in particular.
Yeah. But I think that's... Gareth Southgate's doing a great job. I really hope he stays, because he's really transforming the way the English see football, the way English play football. But you can't expect results straight away. And I think results overshadowed performances in Russia for England. Mm. I think they faced some lesser opposition, shall we say.
Yeah.
And anyway, I'm happy. It's brilliant that Spain...
Yeah, of course you're happy. Yeah.
We get
love it.
Love it.
Yeah, we know. Simon, what did you make of that 2-1 defeat?
I thought England played all right. The goal they scored was excellent. The passing was sublime. Mm. I just thought they were really weak at the back. I think the comments about the World Cup are probably fair. They had a very easy run and they were pretty mediocre, particularly in open play. But I think if they can get a bit more creative in the middle and look over a kind of 10-year window, we could genuinely see England become a world-class team.
And let's not forget, there was a controversial disallowed goal.
Oh, stop it, Jack.
I think English fans have a pretty good case. Do you not?
No. Welbeck clearly takes De Gea's legs out as he goes to get the ball. And then it's a great finish from Welbeck, but I think it's the right call at the end of the day. But I'm biased.
I didn't think he got in the way too much, to be perfectly honest. I thought it looked like he wasn't doing anything purposefully anyway. What did you make of it, Jack?
It had a bit of a rugby line-out sort of feel to it, didn't it? I think he was impeding the goalkeeper, wasn't he? Like, he seemed to get in the way and sort of deliberately kind of want to play the man rather than the ball, so...
I think there was enough contact to suggest that it was a foul.
I think it's a classic example of goalkeepers being a protected species, you know? Any kind of touch and it's referee blows for it.
Yeah. I mean, England bounced back, defeating Switzerland in the end, so it's not all tears for English
fans. This morning. But, again, I mean... You expect them to maybe beat Switzerland. I think that's a better estimation or way of showing where they're at the moment. Mm. And look, I think there's positive signs for England. They just have to build on what they've accomplished.
Yeah. So what do we know and what do we understand about the UEFA Nations League at the moment? Slightly confusing.
Confusing situation, isn't it? Because there's still friendlies as well as UEFA Nations League and, of course, the European Championship at the end of that as well.
Yeah.
But basically what they've done is they've looked at the schedule and they've seen all these kind of international friendlies that would otherwise be sort of dead rubbers or pointless, you know, in people's opinion, and thought, how can we make this a little bit more interesting?
Yeah.
And created this sort of system where you can qualify for the Euros through a kind of convoluted kind of league system with relegation and promotion as well. So it does give a little bit more edge to those
They're trying to inject meaning into otherwise meaningless.
Absolutely.
To get rid of friendlies, I think, is the big thing for people, because it's just produced these meaningless clashes that no one really wants to play anymore. And it sort of rewards good teams who, you know, these lower league teams have something to play for now. They can get promoted like a league format.
It is a catch-22 because no one likes a meaningless game, but at the same time, you have to have international teams being active and playing to develop. But how you make that interesting is probably not the solution we're seeing right now.
I still just think the timing of the window is odd from a club perspective, in that you're just hitting momentum in the European club season, and then let's get rid of that for a couple of weeks.
Stop enjoying yourself.
And start from scratch, we are, of course, and what did you describe it as? A golden dawn of Welsh football.
Well, it's a new generation coming through, Jack. It's very exciting. We've got Giggsy in charge now.
Yeah.
And we saw, the first home game where they thrashed Ireland 4-1, which was kind of like a bit of revenge, really, for Ireland, stopping us qualifying for the World Cup, basically. So it was a beautiful thing to do, beautiful thing to see. And you've got a nice crop of young players coming through as well. And Welsh fans are actually very... optimistic. Well, they were until we lost 2-0 to Denmark.
Denmark, which actually managed to sort itself out because, of course, we were staring down the barrel of a futsal team at one stage.
Yeah, it's a bit of a shame that kind of did sort it out in the end. But
I don't think you can call it a golden dawn of Welsh football if you're relying on the opposition to get a team of non-professional players.
But how much worse would it have been had we lost to them?
Yeah, this is true.
You know what I mean? It's good that we actually lost to a decent side.
Neymar's theatrics in the World Cup came back to haunt him just a little bit.
He just can't shake it. I think he's going to have to dog this for the rest of his career. Just people making fun of him, or whatever he does, there's always going to be that cloud hanging over him about his theatrics, his diving.
Is he sort of owning it now, though?
Well, I think he's accepted it more than anything. I think he came out sort of apologised and admitted, after the World Cup, I did sort of dive a little bit. I exaggerated. I think exaggerated is a bit light. He was just terrible during the World Cup, and he's paying for it now.
Well, it's bad that it's become so publicly known that he's, an exaggerator, shall we say, of these fouls, because, any ref, who actually sees that a foul has been committed on him might even be hesitant to kind of award that because they know of the backlash.
It's the boy who cried wolf, isn't it?
Yeah. Absolutely.
How does a player go about changing their perception, Simon?
You become Vinnie Jones, I guess. You just become super hard and you don't let anything knock you over. But for a guy that's so slight and small, he's going to really struggle with that.
In saying that, Cristiano Ronaldo was always slated as a diver, and he slowly turned that around and stayed on his feet more as he's gotten older.
The problem is, though, that when you're going in the wrong direction with the whole simulation thing, if you become known as a player who dives, you get that reputation very quickly, right? So all it takes is one World Cup and everyone says Neymar is this guy who's diving on the ground all the time. But then, when you want to go the other way, you want to repair your reputation, it takes a long time. I mean, Ronaldo's turned his reputation around, over 7 or 8 seasons rather than overnight.
Mm. But I think we're going to get more situations like we did in that friendly with Brazil in the US, where Yedlin, the Newcastle right-back, goes to the referee and says, did you not watch the World Cup? This is Neymar. This is Neymar we're talking about. He's going to do this. He's going to exaggerate. He's going to milk everything he can. So I think there's going to be more and more doubt in referees' minds, particularly when situations like that come up and they go, well, it's Neymar. And I think it already started happening with him.
Yeah.
The other thing is, I think, and this comes back to what you said last week, Jack, is that Neymar's not actually that good. Ronaldo.
No, I agree. He's the England of individual football. I just think overrated.
I think that's part of the reason why Ronaldo has been able to turn that reputation around, is because he's let his football do the talking rather than his rolling
and
around.
And his abs. You guys see that Instagram this week? Goodness, what did he say? Vitamina D. Bit of vitamin D. Getting a bit of sun.
That Peter Crouch biography that's come out.
Yeah.
The tidbit where he said Rio Ferdinand told him that Ronaldo used to watch himself in the mirror and tell himself how sexy he was.
Come on.
Naked.
Put yourself in Ronaldo's boots for a moment.
Or his leopard print short. Yeah.
Exactly. Hey, I want to get your thoughts on whether or not Essien's actually going to be coming down and playing for the Wellington Phoenix, because that could be very interesting. We will wrap up the Chatham's Cup as well in just a couple of minutes. Kia ora koutou. Welcome back to TVNZ Football Club. Kei te whakamaa tātou I te wiki o te reo Māori. We're celebrating Māori Language Week. I'm here with Jack Mabea, Victor Valdez, Waters and Simon Plummer this morning. So Barcelona have applied to go and play a La Liga game in Miami, Florida, of all places. What do you make of this? Because the players themselves don't seem to be that happy.
Yeah, I think it's obviously the money talking, right? I mean,
no,
there's no,
no,
reason,
Jack.
But I mean, because
Barcelona needs so much
money. Is it letting down the fans back at, you know, back at home? They get to see, I guess, you know, dozens of matches every year, but there's fans all over the world now. I mean, football is a global game, so.
But I mean, increasingly we see in the off season we see clubs going, you know, taking the games around the world. That's different. But to actually have a sanctioned La Liga game in the US, in Miami, where of course there's a big Latin community, that's a whole different kettle of fish.
For me, it's a step far too far. I think you're taking the soul out of the game by doing this, and. It's not Barcelona who it's going to affect as much. It's Girona. It's the team that they're meant to be playing in that fixture. For them, this is their biggest game of the season. That's where they're going to get the most money out of their home fans. And to take that away from a small club like Girona is just terrible for the game. I'm completely against it being played in the US or outside of Spain. It needs to. It's just wrong. I just think it's wrong. I understand that football needs to become more global and you know, you've got to develop the game in developing football nations like the US, if we want to call it that.
You can call it developing nations?
Developing nations.
No, I get what you mean. There's a lot of money. There's a lot of opportunity.
I think you're just taking football away from the fans who are basically who make half the game apart from the players.
I agree. And I think, as you mentioned, the pre-season is the time to do that. It's kind of the travelling circus, if you like. But I think during the actual competitive window, if you were a fan who'd bought your season ticket, you'd definitely you'd want a discount on that, wouldn't you? Mm.
But I mean, for the majority of people that are watching on TV, it wouldn't make any difference at all, right?
That's true.
You know, for us, the time zone would probably be a bit easier. Whoa.
This is La Liga trying to, I think, for me, catch up with the Premier League in terms of marketing and globalisation, because that's what the Premier League has over La Liga. A lot of people say La Liga is better technically and tactically than the Premier League, but in terms of advertising and sales and all that, the Premier League moves more money. I think La Liga's obviously started with this idea and they're trying to gather more money from it.
Other leagues could follow that, I mean, if this is a success. Because I know the Premier League's been looking at playing games overseas as well.
I mean, you could compare it to rugby, right? You had the Crusaders playing at Twickenham. I mean, it's not unheard of. From the glamour of La Liga to the Chatham Cup, Birkenhead did the business on penalties. Anything to say about it?
Well, congratulations to them.
Well done, guys. Well done. No, it's good to see the Kate Shepherd Cup too. Dunedin.
It's great to see
Tech getting up. Was it 4-2 over Forest Hill? Over Forest Hill, Milford United. Chris Wood named New Zealand Player of the Year. I suppose with Winston Reid injured, that was kind of no great surprise, was it?
No real competition, was there really? But at the same time, not to take away from what Chris has done over the last season, he's been a great advocate for New Zealand football and done great for Burnley as well. Let's hope he can
He's looking pretty good this season so far.
I don't think he... has he got one or two goals? He's got a couple. But to come off that season last season where he scored 10, that's a big, you know, achievement, particularly for someone, you know, who's just come into the league again, playing in the Championship. He's just got to build on this. It's going to help them so much not to play in the Europa League for Burnley because they've got such a small squad. So I think he's just got to knuckle down and focus. Hopefully he stays fit. And we see him back in an all-whites jersey soon.
Okay. Chelsea, Real Madrid, AC Milan. Come on, Phoenix. Is there any chance we're going to see AC in Wellington?
On holiday.
It's an interesting rumour, that. I mean,
what do you do? What does a club like the Phoenix, how do they sell a club career with the Wellington Phoenix?
Well, they've categorically ruled it out. But I definitely think it's the right direction in what they need to do. They need to get these sort of, I'm sorry
Asian
to Michael
stars.
Lester, washed up stars. But you've got to get bums on seats. You've got to get more attention to the Phoenix.
Well, this is a legitimate question. What does the Phoenix do to get someone Essien-esque to the club? What can they possibly offer? Because, I mean, in terms of money...
Living in God's own New Zealand.
Well, I guess that's it. I mean, if you've been earning, you know, £100,000 a week to then... You know, so well. What can we offer you? Really good coffee. I mean, I don't know how you go about it.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, why would you come here? You wouldn't come for good money. You wouldn't come for good football. The only option really is your quality of life. If he's got a young family, he might be keen.
It's an experience.
But I think it's also what other offers would he have on the table? You know, at that stage of his career, having played in all those big clubs and moved around the world, perhaps he's thinking one more payday. You know, it's an easy kind of place to go. levels probably would suit him.
What it has done, though, is get people talking about the Phoenix.
Right.
Mm. So maybe the people that actually started the rumour had a vested interest in that.
But yeah.
I wonder if there was any genuine interest or what was going on there behind the scenes.
Yeah, let's not forget that we have Usain Bolt sniffing around.
Yes, he'll be here in December.
Yeah, yeah.
If all goes well, he will be on New Zealand shores soon.
If all goes well. It's a big if. Okay, we're going to keep moving. Great to see you, Jack Mabeer, Victor Valdez Waters and Simon Plummer. That is all for this week on the TVNZ Football Club. Remember, you can find us on the One News website, YouTube and Facebook pages, and as a podcast in all the usual places. Just search for TVNZ Football Club. We'll see you next week. Hey, Cornada.